Hello and welcome to another episode of the Australian Ghost Whisperer. I am your co-host James Jennings with Caterina Legato.
Hello, James.
Hello, Caterina. Here we are again.
Yes. Wonderful. I'm loving this.
It's good. We're getting
so much fun.
Yeah, it's I appreciate, and I'm sure everyone who's listening or watching appreciates you sharing so many of your amazing stories and knowledge, because it's not really the kind of insight you can just get anywhere.
No.
You know,
it's very valuable information, and I felt like it was time to share my experiences because it has been so intensive and I've covered so many things in my career.
Yeah.
And often people kind of ask me and I don't have time to kind of go through it, so this is a great opportunity to educate and give a better understanding and hopefully help everyone else on their journey.
Yeah, absolutely. And today we're actually going to tackle something which I'm sure has gone through everyone on the planet's mind at some point.
Okay.
Which is, what happens when you die?
Wow.
But not only what happens when you die, what does it feel like to die? Now, not everyone is going to obviously come back to actually
tell us,
but you have had that experience. So you actually...
I actually asked my guides to have that experience.
Wow.
Willingly.
Willingly.
To have a near-death experience.
So not only have...
No medics on hand, nothing.
You're brave.
Yeah, I'm curious though.
Well...
Always had a curious...
streak.
Yeah.
Well, your curiosity is to our benefit, because we're actually going to be able to hear you tell us about it. So obviously you can see the other side and you've seen what that is from a human perspective. But by asking your guides, hey, what's it feel like to die? And what happens? You were given a first-hand insight into this. So please tell us about this.
Okay, so it was a night and I had been contemplating what it really felt like to die. What's the process? How do you feel as you're dying? Is it scary? What is it? So I went into a very, very deep state of meditation. Now, I'm not recommending that anybody do this.
Mm-hmm.
You have to understand that I am so experienced with energy, and so I am very experienced in taking myself into a very deep state where I'm able to disconnect from my physical body. But I'm also, what I do in those circumstances is build a great deal of protection around me, so I don't have any intrusions from any of the darker realms stepping in.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel very divinely protected when I proceed into any type of this type of work. And so that's what I did that night. And I felt divine guidance and divine spirit around me in the presence of God. So formed a protective circle, a protective space in which I knew I would be quite safe to move away from my body and go through the experience of what it would feel like upon my own death when my time comes.
So you were getting like a sneak preview.
Yes, which is exactly what I asked for. And I'd been asking kind of for a while, so... Yeah, I kind of felt like I was ready to go through that process. So I took myself, obviously, first into a very deep state where I was able to just let go of any thinking, of any external noises, of anything that was going to distract me. And I felt myself going very, very deeply inside of myself and really connecting in with my divine spark, and then from there connecting in with my light body. And I began to feel as though my breath was dissipating more and more, like it was like that was kind of leaving me. My breath was leaving me. And as the more my breath left me, the more I began to feel this feeling of feeling quite free, of feeling like all the weight of the 3D body of our avatar was just leaving me, the weight, the concerns, the worries, the connections, even the, you know, we always feel that we have deep connections to people. It was like that all left me and I was no longer able to think, but I felt the presence of love on such a deep level, and I felt the presence of love. And it was unlike anything I've ever experienced in the physical world. It began to consume me and overwhelm me to the point where I could not, like I said, think about what I was doing anymore or who I was leaving behind. And quite frankly, I feel like had I gone through the entire process and died, it would have been fine.
Wow.
All fear left me, and I just felt the presence of love wrapping itself around me, and I became much more aware of my spirit self, my soul, my divine spark, and it felt quite golden and bright, luminescent. And I felt that there was no time any longer. I just existed in, and I was eternal. I didn't feel there was a beginning or an end. It was like I was this eternal being, and I was all things and everything at the same time, if that makes sense.
Wow.
Yes.
So did you still retain a sense that you were Katarina, or was Katarina just like your human identity that just kind of washed away?
That washed away quite a bit in that. It washed away. I was no longer able to think of my name. I was not a name. I was not a person. I was this eternal being of pure love and light, and I was part of the greater of all things that are good, of all things that are pure. I was part of that, and my awareness expanded. I was able to experience, for example, the stars, and I became a star. And if I felt like I was experiencing the sky, I became the sky. I felt myself amalgamate with whatever it was that I felt through my heart that I needed to experience. And then I felt this being of light, and it had wings, but it wasn't an angel. It was like almost it had this head of a lion, and it was this magnificent, powerful being of light. And I kind of connected with it, and I felt myself flying with this being, and I was lifted higher and higher, and I felt myself looking down, and the planet Earth was so small, so distant from me, and I looked down on the Earth, and I remember just feeling love for the life and the people I was leaving behind. But it was okay. I wasn't sad like I have on this planet, people I love, my own daughter. And it was like I wasn't, there was no sadness. It was just a knowing that we're all one, and she's still a part of me, and we will be together again. So I was really ready to go. And so it was this amazing feeling of freedom, of this heaviness. That was the most amazing part of it. All the burdens of the earthly life were lifted. And the more that I connected with this being that flew, the higher we went. And then I was part of the planets. And beyond that, I was the part of the universe. And I felt my oneness with all that God has created. And the majesty and magnificence of Creator God.
That is absolutely incredible.
So then from there, this being took me to this very beautiful, magical realm. And there was crystalline waterfalls, but it wasn't liquid water. It was crystalline. It was very fluorescent, and it changed frequency. As I kind of stood under this waterfall, I didn't feel wet, but I felt energized and the purity, and it would change from blues to golds to aquamarine to greens. And I felt these crystals under my feet, and it was like entering this magical kingdom of trees that almost that I connected with. I could almost communicate with these trees. I could communicate with the water, the waterfall, the crystals. And there were other beings of light that were there shining and smiling. And I felt so safe. I felt like, oh my God, like this is home. I felt like I had obviously come to my home from where I obviously came from. And it was pure magic and pure perfection, and everything I felt just appeared. The more love I felt, the more everything just communicated with me. gently, softly, loving. Yeah. The wind caressed me. There was a breeze and it caressed me. The water was sparkling and red, and I felt my soul like just taking in this light and this crystalline energy after the physical journey. It was like, oh, it was restoring me. It was it was such a healing journey.
Okay.
Unfortunately, we got to a point.
Uh-oh.
Sorry, guys.
This wasn't so good.
Where I felt the voice. I believe it was the voice of Source, of God.
Yeah.
That said, okay, now we've allowed you this experience. You still have so much work to do.
Oh.
And you can share this story because people have such a fear of death, and there's nothing to fear of. If you fear death, then you will end up making this process so much more difficult because fear then brings in fearful things around you, and you may begin to sort of feel quite lost. And but if you stay in your heart, so the whole journey, I just stayed in that presence of love, and I just kept going with the presence of love, and it guided me. It was like this guiding, it was like a hand was just lifting me and showing me what I needed to see, so that I could come back and share this with people. And I know that we've all lost loved ones, and whatever the process is, and no matter how they have died, and sometimes in the most dreadful of circumstances, there is an almighty, divine, holy presence of love that is there to take you, to heal you, to restore you.
I'm speechless.
That is non-judgmental.
Yeah.
That is just pure love. And what I came back from was understanding that we are that energy. We are so much more than just our physical bodies.
Mm.
And our time here is just short.
Yeah.
But we are so much more. We are so expanded and able. We are the stars. We are the trees. We are the beach, the ocean, we are part of that, and that exists within us. And so when you allow yourself to experience that and to know that and to feel that, you begin to expand your awareness and you go beyond all the physical problems and all the physical dramas that are here on this physical world that distract us from truly ever knowing who we really are. And we are so much greater than just people that go to work, have a job, go home at night, have dinner, flop in bed, to take kids to school. We are so much more than that.
Why do you think that the human experience for a lot of people is so narrow? And like our perception of what we are, who we are, what we are capable of, it really seems like it's narrow. It's the best word I can use to describe it. What is that our doing? Is that the doing of Source? Has Source chosen that we would have a narrower view of reality here? Like,
absolutely no. God did not intend us to have this very narrow experience on planet Earth. I feel that coming down to planet Earth to be born into this realm that we call planet Earth, somehow we descended. We descended somewhere along the line in our progression, our soul progression. We descended here. We fell here, and this planet unfortunately is run and controlled by dark entities that keep us locked into this constriction and slavery. And so therefore we become more and more distracted by our jobs, making money, feeding, mortgages, all the things that plague our lives and keep us from really exploring the greatness of who we are.
Yeah.
And also, again, because this is a planet of duality, many times we are all just experiencing the negative side of life rather than stepping away from that and choosing to experience the greatness of who we are. We do not invest enough time into the development of our spirit, our soul. We do not spend enough time being grateful for who we are or finding what we're really here to do. You know, we all have some form of a mission that we've come here, but we do not get sometimes the opportunity to follow that because, again, the distractions on this planet are so great. And so it keeps us in this place of where we feel restricted, repressed, suppressed.
Right, so my question is, if evil entities are controlling Earth or this realm, why does God not step in and help so that we aren't under the control of these things? Or is the thought of looking to an outside source like God to come in and solve that problem not the right way to think about it? Like, I'm just curious as to, you know, obviously God loves us, then why are we in a situation where we are in the grip of evil, basically?
Okay. Firstly, it's very important. What my near-death experience taught me or showed me very clearly is that we are as God. We are gods within. We have the spark of God. We have our DNAs of God. We have the power and the magnificence within us to change this reality if we so choose. Unfortunately, there are too many people running on ego and they are not doing the inner work, they are not healing, they are not investing time in their own personal growth and their connection with the inner divine. And so when they do this, they are creating or powering up the demonic realms, the archons, the reptilians that are unfortunately plaguing this earth and wanting to keep humanity
low.
Yeah. Because it feeds them. You see, the fear, the sadness, the grief, the pain, all the suffering of the earth, all the suffering of it comes. It feeds, it is like food for them. They need a constant supply of this energy that is fear-based to give them the ability to continue to coexist with us and keep this world of duality going.
Is it correct to say that it's almost as though, you know, God has gifted us all with free will, and it's almost like we have a choice. Each individual person has a choice to either follow the path of ego, negativity, materialism, or a path of open-heartedness, love, kindness, gratitude, all of those sorts of things. Is it like, you know, those paths that are presented there for us and we have the power to choose them? Because, I mean, the thing is like, we live in the same world that everyone who's chosen darkness has chosen, yet we haven't chosen that. We have chosen a path of trying to become enlightened, be loving, grateful, all those positive aspects. So in the way that we've chosen that and other people have chosen their path, is it safe to say that God is basically leaving it in our hands to decide where it goes?
We are the masters of this reality. It is up to us, again, where we take this existence. So again, it's the scales of balance. When we have enough people living from their hearts, existing from their hearts, we will lift the others that are still struggling to find that light and feel that light and love within them. And as we lift them, we take the planet into a higher vibration where darkness can no longer coexist with us.
Right.
But we have to change many things.
Well, I've got to say,
in order, like we need to stop destroying the planet, you know,
Killing animals, killing species, you know, destroying the natural
turning the ocean fishless. We need to become God-like beings and act as God would act. God did not create anything for the intention of it to be destroyed, murdered, killed, raped, for all species. See, the problem also is that the ego has made many people believe that it is just us, the humans, that are important on this earth.
Yeah.
But we are part of a huge ecosystem.
Yes.
And when we break down one part of the ecosystem, then it's again a domino effect. And the more we break it down, the less of the light and love we create, and the more destruction we begin to create. So it is up to us to lift each other through love, through compassion, and come together for the greater benefit of all life. Because God breathed life into everything that God created on this planet. And so imagine, it's like a mother has, say, four children. She will love those four children equally. There won't be one that she will say, I love more than the other. A mother will love all of her children. Well, God loves all of what God created.
Yeah.
God's love, God's soul, God's energy and presence lives within everything, within the trees. And that's what I saw in that need effort, that God was present in all things. And this is where we need to get to that greater understanding that we really shouldn't even be stepping on an ant. And I know that that might sound, wow, that's so out there, but everything that is on this earth that is good, nature, everything that God created here is good, and it is part of God's creation.
It's
that
not
God
meant to be harmed.
Breathed love and life into. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. And I guess that's the problem, is like people have been, I don't know if it's tricked or deceived or whatever, but they believe that things are separate. So I'm separate from the earth.
The duality.
I am separate from nature. I'm separate from the animals.
But this was set up by the dark, the false god. The false god. There is also a false god that has set up this system for all of us to feel separate to everything.
Right.
We only feel connected to our families or our loved ones or the people we choose to be around.
Yeah.
See, this whole system has been set up that we lose our true self in, and we find ourselves running on need and fear and greed. Have I got enough money? Have I got enough food? Have I got enough for this? We begin to believe in the lack. And the more we believe in the lack, the more we create lack, because we are creators. God is a creation. Therefore, we are made in the image of God, so we are creators. So the more we create fear and greed and lack, the more we feed the dark god, the false god. And that begins to have more power over our lives and over the earth. And then we feel like Creator God is nowhere to be found.
Yeah.
But Creator God is within us. It never left us. We just believe that God left us, but
no.
It never left us.
Yeah. And I think a lot of people as well, they're happy to kind of take the mindset that they're not a divine being, and they go, "Oh, well, I'm just an animal." So to them it's like, you know, I eat, I have sex, I sleep. You know, like they have very base sort of...
They're living from their base chakra.
Right.
So this is where it's about coming into the heart chakra now and living from the heart, which is the most powerful chakra. And so humanity for too long has lived from the lower three chakras, which is all about survival.
Yeah.
Survival for the fittest.
Yeah.
When you live from the heart, you feel unity to all things.
Mm. And you can't do harm when you're in that state of being.
You wouldn't choose. Or you would do the less harm possible.
Yeah. Yeah. Going back to your near-death experience and back to you being in that state of basically experiencing what it was to be dead and to have passed over.
Yeah.
Were you able to, you said that you looked back on the planet and it was like a, you know, very tiny little marble. Were you able to get a greater sense of humanity and what they were and what they were experiencing from that perspective?
When I glanced down back at the planet, I felt that I just needed to cry and I had to kind of move away from that. The moment I actually looked down on the planet, I felt myself being drawn back to the sadness and the grief. Although there was love here too, but it felt like I was being sucked back into it, into kind of not such a happy place.
Right.
So I had to disconnect to keep my focus in my heart.
Mm.
And so the more I did that, the more higher and the more free and the more my awareness expanded, my consciousness expanded, and I just felt the oneness with the universe and the many universes. It was like I could be the presence of all that has been created was within me. It wasn't separate.
So separation is an illusion, essentially.
Absolutely. It really is. It's what keeps us stuck in the dark space.
And is it God's intention that as humans we evolve out of that mindset, or is it that we have to find a way in these trying times to be in our heart space and evolve beyond it?
It is absolutely imperative that we come back into our hearts and bring the love into the planet. We can't just think that we're going to keep exploiting and exploiting until there will be nothing left. And I think we're already seeing signs of it. So eventually the resources of this planet will run out.
Yeah.
And I hope we don't get to that. But I feel that there is an awakening also occurring, and people are more aware now. People are seeking to heal. People are worrying about the future of the earth and what is really happening.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of positives where I feel that we can heal, but the healing must begin with ourselves. We must spend and dedicate time to be in the presence of our own hearts.
Yeah.
And feel our emotions, whether they are sad, whether they are, you know, whether we need to cry or grieve, go into that space of pain, feel it, and then you can deal with it. You can let it go. You can cry, you can scream, whatever. But if you keep suppressing pain on top of pain on top of pain, you will never be able to experience inner peace, feel love for yourself, let alone anyone else. And any love that these people do feel is very short-lived, is temporary, because they do not know how to be in the presence of love for longer than a few weeks or a few months. You see, this is why a lot of people have so many issues connecting and forming loving relationships, because they are very uncomfortable in the presence of love. And they need to run from it, because when you go into the presence of love, then you must, love will bring to the surface all that is unlike it. And then you must face those things within you. But it's okay. You know, I say to people, I take them through process, it's okay to feel the pain you suppressed when you were 3 years old. It's okay, because the spark, the love force within you will help you and assist you.
I've experienced that with you as well during healing sessions in the past, so I know how that feels. It's powerful to let those things go and to allow that healing and love in. But even, I mean, look, I've been in relationships where what you said is exactly what's transpired, which is in the presence of love, some people don't really know what to do. Mm. They can run from it. They can, it's too much.
That's right.
Yeah.
And sometimes you can feel that you're connected or attracted to someone through your pain body and their pain body, and you think that that's love, but it's just you're feeling that connection because you're feeling their pain and your pain, and it all kind of feels comfortable because it's hard. If you're filled with pain, it's really difficult to connect with someone who's filled with love.
Yeah.
Because the two energies can't connect.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you will always be seeking people that can reflect your pain back to you because you feel comfortable. And these relationships tend to be temporary.
Yeah.
There's no longevity in them because after a while that pain starts to surface and you've got two people who are just living through pain and pushing each other's buttons and getting to the point where they have to run from each other because they can't be together.
Yeah. Well, that makes perfect sense.
I have so many people. The biggest issue that I have found in 30 years of doing this work is the biggest issue is people find it difficult to love themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know how, and they find it difficult to form a loving, romantic, soulmate, however you want to call it, relationship.
Mm. Mm.
This is the biggest challenge.
Yeah, I'm not surprised to hear that because that's what a lot of people are seeking, and it's and in fact perhaps a topic for another podcast is that whole thing about how you can't actually find external love until you have nurtured that internal love for yourself.
Yes,
it's
I had to go through that journey myself.
Mm, as did I. Yeah.
So.
Mm. But cycling back to your near death experience, so I think. In terms of chronologically talking about this experience, even though there is no time in the afterlife, so chronological doesn't even exist, but God said we've given you this insight so you can tell other people.
Correct.
What happened next?
So, as I said, I was just in this blissful state and I felt like I knew all things and all things, everything was self-aware, and at some point I felt it wasn't exactly, it was like a voice, but an inner knowing of this was just something for you to experience and tell people about, but you need to return to your body and you still have things to do here. So it was very disappointing. But then I felt that being that had guided me, was this incredible, beautiful being, begin to kind of come in, and I started to feel myself coming down through the light, through many layers, through many, I guess, different frequencies, and it became more and more physical, more and more. I felt I was starting to ground into my body, and I felt the breathing and the beating of my heart, and I still felt though the tingling and the healing and the love of that experience, that when I fully came back I just was crying because I just felt myself crying. I had felt this love that I felt like I'd known this love and that this love was who I really was, and I had lost that connection. I felt like, oh my God, I had, for that short period of time, I felt whole, complete. I felt like I was who I really was. So
it's beautiful.
It was beautiful, and I just cried and cried, and I thought, oh God, I never want to forget this feeling.
Wow, that's priceless.
I'm very grateful.
Yeah.
I'm very grateful that I've had the privilege of being able to ask for these experiences and be able to have them.
Mm.
But I've had to work very hard and dedicate my life to my own personal growth.
Yeah.
Mm. Otherwise, I would not be able to help anyone else.
Mm. Well, maybe there's people listening or watching who've had their own near-death experiences. Mm. I would say drop us a line.
Yes.
Find us on social media, or, you know, you'll find an email address or a way to contact us, I'm sure. But we'd love to hear from you, because I think, I'd love to interview some other people who've had these experiences. Oh, I'd love to. There are Facebook groups for near-death experiences, and I read those stories a lot. And the stories are all very common. Mm. Like, there's common threads, and everything that you've said is very similar to what other people say. Mm. Sometimes people talk about dark things happening or going through darker realms on their way to the light, or
because at some point they would have felt fear.
Right, right.
So fear will automatically draw you into dark realms, because right. as you're moving through the densities, you've got to move from through the lower densities
mm.
in order to raise yourself into the higher density. Yeah. So you will, in your death, you must go through those lower densities. And how I got through them was just staying in my heart and not allowing myself to give energy to those dark densities, and so that way I pass through them very quickly.
Okay, well, that's good advice for anyone who's in a situation where they've passed over. It's like, stay in your heart, and
your heart love will guide you.
Mm.
Truly will.
And that's good advice for life in general, really.
Yeah.
Mm.
Love will always guide us if we allow it to be so.
Yeah. Mm. Well, that might be a nice, profound note to wind up this particular episode with. So thank you again for sharing your amazing stories.
Thank you.
And, like I said, please contact us. We'd love to hear from you if you have similar stories. And, we will be back again to talk more. Please
let us know about any other subjects that you might be interested in.
Absolutely.
We'll be able to talk about them in our shows.
Yeah, absolutely. And we will probably be doing live Q&As online and things like that soon as well. So if there is a burning question that you have, there'll be a way to contact us. And, we'd love to interact and sort of get to know more about you guys and what you want to know about and what you've experienced.
Yeah, and I'd like to eventually run journeys and classes and meditation, and also help people to begin to resolve their issues and go into their hearts. This is something that is just so important, and it's like our part in helping to transform the world and take it to a happier space. And I think that everybody wants to see that happen.
Absolutely, well said.
Mm.
All right. Well, we'll sign off. Thank you, Kat.
Thank you, and God bless, and have a beautiful day.
Indeed. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you next time.